Now, who's next? Deputy Richard Boyd Barrett, please.
Tánaiste, Minister, this is the week that Donald Trump has declared war on the people of Palestine and the wider Arab and Muslim world by recognising Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, threatening to inflame conflict right across the Middle East. Now, against that background of warmongering, increased militarism by Trump, it is more important than ever that Ireland holds on to its traditional position of military neutrality and opposing warmongering and militarism. And yet, it is precisely in this week that the government has rammed through and quite successfully to this point buried what is the biggest betrayal of Irish neutrality since the decision to allow US forces use Shannon Airport to bomb Iraq back into the dark ages. The vote that will take place today for us to join permanent structured cooperation on a new common defence project in the European Union is an absolute betrayal of Ireland's military neutrality. It is a step towards involvement in what is explicitly being touted by Donald Tusk, by Juncker, by Macron, by Mogherini as a new European army and common defence pact. And you have buried this. You misled the business committee. Because the decision to join PESCO was taken, we were informed by Minister Keogh, who didn't know much else, frankly, about this, but the one thing he informed us last night was this decision was taken on the 21st of November, and yet, for two committee meetings afterwards, not a mention that you were planning to push this vote through this week. No doubt you've been briefing the media that there's nothing to see here. This isn't relevant, it's not significant, there's no legal implications, but the truth is, this is us joining up in a common defence, which will require us to regularly, I'm quoting, increase defence budgets in real terms to meet the 2% of GDP benchmark. That would mean a quadrupling of Irish defence expenditure. These are binding, I'm quoting, common commitments. It will involve bringing our defence apparatus into line with other member states. It will involve establishing permanent interoperability with NATO. It will involve increased expenditure on arms and weaponry to benefit the European military industrial complex. And my question is not only why have you misled the country and tried to bury this significant betrayal of Irish neutrality, but I want to ask you seriously, is this not unconstitutional? Apart from everything else, is it not unconstitutional? Article 29(4)(9) of our Constitution says the following. The state shall not adopt a decision taken by the European Council to establish a common defence pursuant to Article 42 of the Treaty of the European Union where that common defence would include the state, our state. Now, this is a common defence. It is explicit. Anybody who wants, who doubts that should read the PESCO agreement.
Thank you.
We are signing up to a common defence in defiance of our own constitution. And you've misled the public, you've misled the Dáil, and played fast and loose with the business committee.
Tánaiste.
Well, look, I can agree with the deputy on something, and that is I agree with his concerns in relation to the recognition of Jerusalem yesterday by the United States. And the instability, in my view, that that potentially may lead to. I made contact with the US Embassy to express our concern when we had heard reports that that might happen. And we strongly made our view known that we did not think it was a good idea at this time, and that Jerusalem is one of the permanent status issues which is to be settled in a final Middle East peace agreement. And it's closely interlinked with other permanent status issues, and they should all be resolved together through negotiation in the context of a broader peace deal that Ireland wants to be very supportive of. And I think that, it is regrettable that in my view, the announcements yesterday evening will make the achieving of that agreement a lot more difficult. What I don't agree with you on, Deputy, is the attempt in this House by you and others to paint PESCO, or Permanent Structured Cooperation, as something that it's not. I'm a former Minister for Defence. I'm somebody who has listened to many debates in relation to this initiative. The truth is, Deputy, that this is simply a structured initiative that allows Member States to opt in and opt out, depending on what they're comfortable with, on different projects. We have other non-aligned countries and neutral countries like Sweden, Austria and Finland that have already signed up. And from an Irish perspective, this is an opportunity for us to essentially share resources and access other resources in areas where we are comfortable in cooperation. And it's no more or less than that on a case-by-case basis. I suspect we will want to use this in terms of counter-terrorism, in terms of peacekeeping and training, in areas potentially like marine surveillance, so that Ireland can be part of collective initiatives when it's appropriate to be part of those collective initiatives in the context of the European Union. As the Taoiseach said yesterday, other countries will see it differently. Other countries may want to get more involved in a more structured way in projects that we will not have an involvement in. And so I would ask the Deputy to actually call this what it is, as opposed to trying to create some kind of conspiracy that simply doesn't exist. This is a conversation that's been happening since the Lisbon Treaty, and it is now something that is coming to finality following a long debate that a lot of countries have been involved in, neutral states, NATO members, and others. And Ireland insisted, as others did, on language in the context of the setting up of PESCO to ensure that it is constitutional, to ensure that it doesn't undermine Irish neutrality, to ensure that the triple lock still applies if we're going to send troops to any other part of the world. And so from that point of view, we have tested this in the context of some of the questions that you've asked. And it does not undermine what is important to Irish people and what is important to me,
thank you, Tánaiste,
which is that Ireland remains non-aligned militarily and a neutral state.
Deputy Boyd Barrett.
That is the most cynical rubbish I have ever heard. Right? And I really appeal to the public and to the press to simply read the document, Notification on Permanent Structured Cooperation. Okay? It includes, for example, binding commitments. First of all, it refers to 20 binding commitments. There's no ambiguity about the language. One of those includes commitment to agree on a common technical and operational standards of forces, acknowledging that they need to ensure interoperability with NATO. That's NATO that involves Donald Trump and the United States, right? That's what we're talking about. We are committing to the integration of Irish Defence Forces with NATO. It commits us, and we still haven't got answers on this, it commits us to real increases in defence budgets, okay? Successive medium-term increase in defence investment, increasing the share of expenditure allocated to defence research and technology, which will be reviewed on an annual basis, a national implementation plan to meet these targets. This is the military equivalent of the fiscal treaty.
Thank you,
and we are signing up to it. And what this is what I'll just conclude on this. This is what Tusk said about PESCO. Its purpose is to protect the bloc from the effects of the migrant crisis and hostile bordering states. Effects of the migrant crisis. That's 35,000 people drowned in the Mediterranean, thanks to Fortress Europe. And they want to militarise the wall that Donald Trump dreams of building. To keep those desperate people out.
You need to conclude.
This is what they're about, and you have deceived the public. And I would just ask this simple question. Give us the legal advice that that doesn't run counter to Article 29.
Thank you, Deputy.
Can you give us that advice before we have to take the vote today?
Thank you.
From the Attorney General that that does not run counter to Article 29 of the Constitution.
Thank you, Deputy Tarnish.
Well, I can tell you, Deputy, that we wouldn't be bringing a vote to this House if we hadn't. Sorry, you know only too well that the AG's legal advice is not published, ever. So, stop asking for things you know you can't access.
Please, Deputy, let the Tarnish to answer.
The AG's responsibility is to give legal advice to the government, and the government then brings proposals to the House that's consistent with that. That's the way this House works. That's the way this House works. In relation to interoperability, Deputy, there's nothing new in that. The Irish Defence Forces have worked with NATO in the past. We've done it in Afghanistan. And any time you send peacekeepers to any part of the world, are you seriously suggesting that our peacekeepers shouldn't be interoperable with colleagues that they work with in parts of the world? Where they put their lives at risk, Deputy, to defend a peace and stability of strangers that they've never met. The problem that you have is that you don't seem to understand the risks that Irish troops put themselves in the pursuit of peace and stability. And my job is to make sure that we reduce those risks by making sure that they have the budgets and the equipment to do the job properly, to make sure that we have enough people in terms of personnel in the Defence Forces, to make sure that they're well equipped and well trained, and to make sure that then when they're working with others, when we make the voluntary decision, and it's confirmed by the triple lock, to send troops to part of the world that they have trained and that they are interoperable in a professional sense with others that they will be working with. And that makes perfect sense to me. It is also absolutely consistent with the new white paper on defence, which was supported and passed in this House.
Deputy,